Welcome back to an edition of the Court of Public Opinion. I'd like to introduce our guest host, George Fanala. Welcome back, George.
Well, thank you, Jennifer. I'm glad to be back on your show.
Well, George, you're going to lay out the case for us, and I'm going to let you take it from here.
Well, I'd like to talk about the virus and what it has taught us and what we've learned. We learned, for example, we can do without a lot of things. All the casinos are shut down. Did you ever believe that would happen? And we found out that we can live without a casino every 50 miles. And then we put our money in other places. We found that the schools are shut down and we can live without the public school system. The bars were shut down and we found out we can live without going to the bar and getting drunk. And so on. There's a lot of things that we found out that we can live without. Even though we were confined to our homes, we learned, I hopefully, to communicate with our wives and our family better, to cook our own food, to fix up our house, the repairs that is needed, and 100 other things, work on the car. In fact, what I did during the entire virus is I wrote a book, a big book, the first time in my life, called, you know, From Hell to Here to Hell and Back, about my life story. So I would have never done that but for the virus. So the virus has had an impact on all of us in the big and little ways. On me, it's had a big impact. This is a big, big book. And it was a job I would have never thought of. I would have been too distracted by going to all these places, sporting events, and going dancing and singing and so forth. But I think we should learn from the virus. We should learn, for example, that we are like a mouse, well, like an elephant being chased by a mouse. I mean, this virus only kills less than 1% of us, yet we're all running around like frightened little children because they scared the crap out of us. Now, what would we do if our enemies introduced the virus or came across a wide-open southern border and it was terminating 50% of our population? Why, based on what I've seen from this little thing, we would really freak out. You know, you talk about total pandemonium. So we've learned from the virus that we can be easily manipulated and fooled into acting. I mean, there are states that have hardly even shut down. They're doing no worse. Countries like Sweden that haven't shut down at all. They're doing no worse. And you know, and yet you've got people from New York, Como, and so forth. They'd like to have you believe we should never open up the country at all for another 6 months. Maybe then not. Because they want to ruin Trump's chances for re-election. That's mainly what it's about, is to keep the economy down. And there's President Trump trying to fight like a good soldier to get this place opened up and get this capitalist economy working. And then we've got the challenge about when we do reopen it, how are we going to reopen it? Are we going to just go back to business and have a casino every 50 miles that sucks all the money out of our town so that we starve the restaurants and little businesses because nobody has any money and breaks up marriages and causes suicides and all kinds of problems? Are we going to just let that go on like before instead of keeping gambling, say, to Vegas and Atlantic City and Reno like we used to? Or are we going to just keep building these casinos everywhere? Are we going to let the public school system be just as corrupt and left-wing and like it was before? Or are we going to be more proactive and get into our school system, go to board meetings, find out what they're teaching our kids. Take a look at those textbooks. I used to teach public school, and if parents ever saw what was put in those textbooks, they'd pull their kids out of school, especially their sons are being totally propagandized. Well, so we're going to get more active and realize that we don't really need the public school system. They need us, and that they make their money based on numbers of us sending our children, our most precious possession. And if a child is indeed your most precious possession, you don't send them someplace to have their mind contaminated any more than you would feed them poisoned food, you know, just because it was cheap and easy. So there's two elements, and there's many more. I mean, you can talk about the government. Are we going to have business as usual, these phony blowings after seeing the way that they have acted during this virus, deliberately depressing the economy? And are we going to put up with this nonsense anymore? I don't think so. I think we've learned from the virus that we can be more independent. We can act more like real men. We can have stronger traditional families. All the things I've been talking about and have started to emerge because of this virus, I found out I could write a book. No dream I would ever take on a monstrous task of going back 120 years with a fine tooth comb, doing all this research and organization, photographs and writing. My God, it was a monstrous job. I never in my wildest dreams thought I could do anything like that, even though it needed to be done. I knew it needed to be done. And I'm sure other people found out the same thing as they worked around their homes on their projects or talked to their families and then acted like heads of families again and fathers and righteous husbands and children got to think, why, hey, I can get along without this and without that, without a constant dumping of crazy music and crazy friends coming to the door all the time and being distracted on my smartphone. Maybe I can play board games with my family. Maybe I can clean my room. A thousand things. I mean, I could go through a long list, but I'm not going to waste everybody's time. I think I've made my point.
Yeah, you laid out the case. You did. You laid out the case for that we don't need institutions to run our lives and be this involved in our home and our family. Like, you know, when I came home from school, that was the end of the day. That was escaping the institution of school. I would say, George, you're a family man. And, you know, because you're my cousin, I consider you the head of the household in a lot of ways because my dad has passed away. My dad would have threw his hat at you. And I just know how my dad would have been. And because you resemble my dad and we all resemble each other so well, it's good to have family and know where you have family roots. And because I was looking at pictures of you and I was looking at pictures of your daughter and I was like, man, we all resemble each other. That's beautiful. And we have a beautiful thing called family and memories. And I was talking to you about, like, when was the last time we ever went to a beach house or beach vacation where we could just be goofy and be a family? Because I don't recall ever going to a beach house. I don't recall ever. I mean, listen, I want to go somewhere where my family can feel warmth, love, and acceptance. And George and I just reconnected. And I met George a couple times at a few funerals, but it was very limited to, as you know, a funeral, things happen, goofy things happen at funerals, where really there was nothing that happened. And just going to a funeral is obviously the only time I ever saw family. And I think you made a good case for COVID because we can do without a lot of things. What we cannot do without is education. We got to learn somehow. And the constructs at home, without prayer in school, it's called, the case is a Supreme Court case, Engle versus Vital. And it was the case on prayer in school. And they wouldn't allow prayer in school. But I'm going to tell you, I've seen more people praying during this pandemic than ever. And it was quite refreshing. It kind of reminds you of what it's really about. It's getting back to family, God, country. You know, like the old Marine Corps values is God, country, and family. So if we can have those values, I might not be able to convince the masses. I'm going to tell you, it takes one family at a time to be convinced that those values were told by and true, because our forefathers said it was self-evident, meaning over time, evidence will prove to you that these constitutional principles are true. You will make mistake after mistake. They're going to keep making mistakes until they realize the Constitution is right on about it. These truths we hold are self-evident. And I think our constitutional principles are more important right now than some of the overreach and of the governors like Michigan, the governor here in Pennsylvania, the overreach, like people still have to go back to work. They still have to go back and provide for their families. You can still have a balance of power in your family. Like, there has to be a balance in everything, checks and balances in small government and in big government. And the same would probably apply everywhere else. There's got to be checks and balances. And how do we do that? We hold each other accountable. We hold our leaders accountable. And what I mean, I'll go a step further. I talked to an aide of one of the representatives in Wayne County, and not in Wayne County, and it was in Montgomery County, and there was legislation on the floor that pretty much died before it even got there, and it really told me a lot about why it's so important to have leaders push for legislation that is conservative. You need conservatives in there pushing for legislation so that conservative legislation doesn't just die on the floor. And that's what exactly has happened with the pro-life legislation. That's exactly what happened with the child abuse legislation. You would think anyone with common sense would want that legislation. And let's be honest, you think that everybody in the houses of government have common sense? Think again. It is not true. A lot of those people think with their emotions and are ideologically driven by their, again, ideology. And it's an ideological war that's going on in. And not to mention the culture war, which you and I talked about. And I'm going to leave you to finish it off from here because of the culture war. It's driven by ideology. And so that we know what the conservative principles are. Conservative principles are not driven or even agenda driven. They are what they are because they are self-evident, and it's proven itself over and over again that when you try to repackage something, it's still the same thing. It's like what you said. It's like putting lipstick on a pig.
Well, I can tell you this, Jennifer. Today is the birthday of my firstborn daughter, Carrie Ann, and I haven't seen her effectively for almost 50 years, 46 years. And it breaks my heart because at the age of 6, she was pretty much gone from me by feminism. And I would love to send her out a happy birthday wherever she's at. I think somewhere in Michigan.
Happy birthday, Jerry-Ann. Your dad loves you.
And, you know, I would love to send her a song on my Facebook page and how I feel about missing her. You know, there's something special about your firstborn. And when a culture gets so corrupted with feminism that it destroys the beautiful bond between a loving father and a beautiful daughter, and it's done that to me 3 times with 3 daughters. And, you know, this is an atrocity. This is a cultural atrocity that these feminists, never mind all the aborted babies that they've sponsored and all the marriages they've destroyed, but they have. I can think of no better way to illustrate it than when I was an engineer in the defense industry. I met a Russian expatriate, and we were talking about communism. He said this to me, and I'll never forget it. He said, if someone comes to you with a bowl of white powder and tells you it's sugar, and you dip your finger in, you say, no, it's salt. You instantly know that. But if somebody comes to you with a bad idea, like communism or feminism, it will take you 75 years or more to figure out that this poison. And he was absolutely right. It took Russia 75 years to figure out that communism was poison. And it may take us 75 or 100 years to figure out that feminism is poisoning our culture and is turning our women into creatures that we cannot even recognize. They're not really mothers and sisters anymore. They're strange creatures in a movement, a radical movement that's trying to wage war on men and boys and they're even their own sons. They don't even know what to do with their own sons. I mean, when you're a radical feminist, and you're all about women, what do when you bear a son? You try to turn him into a girl? Well, you see all of the manifestations of this craziness going on with the bathrooms. And, I mean, they're trying to turn the country inside out to fit their crazy agenda and their dogma and their poorly thought out, convoluted way of thinking about, instead of just reading George Gilder's book, Sexual Suicide or Men and Marriage, and understanding that there's something beautiful about the male-female relationship that the Creator made men and women for a reason.
I saw it really deteriorate after they went homosexual marriage, because clearly the line was drawn right there in the sanctity of marriage and the sanctity of life. It sounds like redundant to the people that are used to hearing it, but like you just said, that was a great example about what the Russian expatriate told you. Like, that's exactly how it is. You can immediately tell the taste from something, but a theology or an ideology of any kind, it's got to be at least investigated, educated into, educated, what I mean is you must be educated about what you're agreeing to. I see a lot of people nod their heads to feminism who typically would not nod their heads at it. Like, I personally have a problem with women trying to change the sex and gender of a little boy. I personally have a lot of difficulties personally as a woman, because it challenges my woman, my female need to want to be protective of a little boy. Like me, I feel like as a woman, it's my responsibility to protect that little boy from a world of feminists. And I cannot believe how many people nod their head at abortion and they don't really understand what they're doing. They really don't know what they're agreeing to. And there's a lot of people doing that.
Can I jump in and interject something here?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
There's a saying that I live by, and it's very, very true if you think about it. People will follow fanatically and blindly any idea that they don't fully understand. And if that isn't the truth, I mean, you've seen it in history with Germany and any warriors. If you fully understand what feminism is about, you would never follow. You would repudiate it. But as long as it's there's a lot of ways of lying. You can lie outright. You can lie by omission. And they lie by omission. They leave a lot of things out. And they sell their little agenda to the Congress and to the newspapers. And these fools don't quite know what they're buying into. They'll write a law and promote it. If they fully understood the implications of this movement, what this crazy war that they're creating between men and women, and what it would mean, the destruction of a nation. I mean, this is how you destroy insects. You sterilize the males, and then there's no more insects. Well, we are effectively doing that in this country. We are sterilizing and demasculating our males to the point where our enemies are saying we're right for the picking because we have no men left in the country, and they don't have any respect. Do you think that our enemies have any respect for these feminists? Think they're going to defend this country? They're not. They know it. This country right now is being kept safe and secure on the backs of the inventions of primarily white males of 50 years ago. And when those are neutralized, God help us, because they will come and conquer us.
It is a culture war, and there's a biblical story going on in a scenario that I don't want to get away from, but it's like watching the four horsemen of the apocalypse ride on, and it will come in different forms. And to me, there's a story about the woman in the scarlet and purple, and I wonder if the woman in the Bible described as the woman that rides the beast is feminism. Because you know how the Bible has a lot of everything's meant for interpretation, I believe. Like, you can interpret it for how you believe it, but the Lord keeps speaking to me about the woman on the beast, and I feel like that woman on the beast is feminism, because if it's responsible for all the abortion and all the culture war stuff, it explains everything that is going on. Also, the women's liberation movement, Libertas, that Libertas is actually not the same meaning as liberty to a woman who wants to wear no bra. Like, there are some women, they can't for medical reasons. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the rebellion of women that want to go braless. Like, it's a form of rebellion. So I think there's a biblical scenario that I don't want you to forget about, because it's playing out it's been playing out for a while. And how we know that? Because of the blood of the saints. And what better word for saints are the unborn children and the people that, who have died innocently over this very issue? Because they don't know what's going on. They don't know what they're not in their head to. And you said it so great. You said something earlier, and I hope that we get a chance to, once we get into the next session, that's if we get back online here tonight or today. But if we don't, we're going to pick up on this topic. I think there's a lot to be said about the culture war and how it's divided the family, and how your family can win, how you can have the tools to win. Because I think this way, whenever I was telling you, George, you are the patriarch of the family. There's really no one else that can fill that role right now. And, you know, you're still the father of your daughter, Jerianne. And happy birthday, Jerianne, because, I mean, I love my cousin dearly. And I know you have a great dad, by the way. And I thank God for the freedoms we have, the liberties we have to share on this Memorial Day, that we can at least, we could do another talk show. Heck, the way we're going, we could do another talk show just on Memorial Day weekend alone.
Yes, we could. And I thank you for wishing my daughter, Carrie Ann, because she really is a well-educated to Boston University and all that, but she needs to shake off the yoke of feminism and realize the gift from God that she was given to have a worthy father and to come back to me. That would be beautiful.
That's right. Just like the prodigal story, the prodigal daughter in this case, or prodigal son, whenever your parents, you know, when they welcome you back with open arms, it's because they love you. And exactly. some of you prodigals, you need to come back to your loving parents who are willing to forgive you and move on and enjoy life again. And I think that's what COVID really taught us, is that we can do without the institutions, the institutional abuses that went with it. We can make it as families, and you just gotta believe. The power of belief is incredible, by the way. And the power of belief, the power of love, it is so incredible. Hey, did you think, George, we would ever accomplish what we accomplished already? I mean, that's the power of belief.
No, I didn't. This has been almost unbelievable, almost like a miracle, Jennifer. And you are an amazing young lady, I can tell you that, you know. You're a rare, rare bird, and you know, and you're doing some real good out there with your sites and your blogging and all the things that you're doing here. I think it's a very generous gift from you to this entire nation.
I hope so, because this show has taken a long time to cultivate this broadcast and get it to the professional level that it needs to be at, and
it's going to get better and better. It's yeah. Better and better.
And we're going to do more broadcasts. And
you know, one thing I have to compliment you about?
What?
You are doing brilliantly. I see many hosts that have bigger shows than you fail at. you are making maximum use of your guest. I see so many of the big talk shows, they bring a person on, they let them talk for 30 seconds, and then they talk over top of them and pump their ego, and you can talk about me kind of people. And I think they make, you know, George Norrie on Coast to Coast is one of the best. He doesn't do that. He does what you do. He brings a guest on, he introduces them, and he lets them talk, and he doesn't humiliate them, make fun of them, talk over top of them, interrupt them, and he is the far and away the most brilliant and successful radio host on the air, George Norrie of Coast to Coast.
Oh, and yeah, George Norrie is great. He is. He's fantastic.
Your technique is along his line, the way you have given me time to get my ideas out without, you know, stomping all over me and interrupting me. That was absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, I really enjoy what you have to say, too. And that's what I think we're going to leave off here, because I think if we do a next segment, which we only do it because of time constraints, or maybe something might be going on because of the Memorial holiday. The good thing is when we tape and record, you can see us on YouTube. You can see us on Google. You can also see us now at Brighteon. And the fact is that I did a promotional video so that everybody knows that George has been co-hosting with me, and I enjoy having you here because, you know, honestly, it would be different without you. I don't think I would be the same person. And I don't know if you know what that vacancy feels like, but, you know, I have George in my life, and I feel a vacancy when he's not around. So, I mean, that's how close family is that, you know, that close kinship we have is because we have love, and we, or else you and I would not have ever connected. Love has to be the key to everything. It's the key to your daughters calling you or making amends. Love is the key to all this. So, love your kids anyway.
There's one other thing that's the key with communication. You've got to have communication.
Absolutely, yeah.
You cannot have people looking down at cell phones constantly and not communicating with each other, because without communication, you have nothing. That's what makes us human.
That's the point of love. That's the point of love. If you love somebody, you're going to want their 110% attention, or something's missing.
And you got to listen to them and have a dialogue with them and really communicate. You know, it can't be a monologue or be one way. It has to be a dialogue. You have to feed off each other, bounce ideas off. And that's how you make progress. And that's what made this great country.
And you know what? We're going to end there, because we're going to talk about that in the next segment, because now I'm going to hold you over. We're going to talk about love.